Good evening. We're continuing our series, the 613 commandments. Last week we arrived to mitzvah number 425. And the last mitzvah we spoke about, not to test a real prophet too much. You give him one or two tests, he proves his point, he can show you that he knows the future, he's a messenger of God. That's, of course, after you know he's a righteous person, he doesn't have any bad record. You know, if it's a questionable person that does bad things against the Torah, that's not the type of person that Hashem will choose to pass his message, right? But if it's a person that is clean, you know, he keeps all the mitzvot, doesn't have, any bad record, and he tells you that Hashem sent him and he gives the message, and then the time comes and it happens, that's it. You don't tell him to make magics. You don't ask him to walk on water. You don't ask him to fly. You don't ask him to change the cow into a dog or anything like this. That's not what the Torah wants you to. And that's where we ended up last week. Today, we are in mitzvah number 425. I'm not sure if we spoke about it last week or not. Anyway, I'll repeat it. It's the seven idols worshiping nations that live in Israel. When the Jews came to Israel, after the exodus of Egypt, 4 years later, they entered the Holy Land. And when they entered the land, there were seven nations that the Torah named them, Chivi, Aprizi, Evusi, Aknaani. All these nations that sat in Israel with their armies, they are all idols worshippers. Now, there are different kinds of Gentiles. There's nations of Gentiles, they're not idol worshippers, like Arabs. They don't worship an idol. And there are nations who worship idols, like today, Indian, Chinese, Hindus, all this, they have all kinds of idol worshipping. But the idol worshipping in the time of the Torah, 3,300 years, was much worse than the things we find today. It was every minute culture. It's everywhere you see big statues, everywhere, just like when you see maybe in Hinduism, and maybe in different kinds of Tibet, China, places like this, it's more similar to the time the way it was. Now, these goyim are the biggest sinners on earth. Even they could be nice people, they're not killing, they're quiet, they work, they live in poverty, whatever, they're really not making any harm physically, but they are the most despicable Gentiles on earth because they make statues and worship them. So whether it's a Jew or a non-Jew, both, it's forbidden for both. So the Torah said that after, you come to the land, you got to clean the Avodah Zarah, and you don't leave any memory from them. You destroy them from the face of the earth with no mercy. You know, they're not stopping with their idols. There's no mercy for them. This is what Hashem say. Why? If they worship idols, they don't deserve to live another minute. You know, so this is a holy war. A holy war. We are talking now that when they sit in the Holy Land, they contaminate the land of God. Therefore, they must be executed. It doesn't apply to our time. We are not, in Israel, you don't have the Israeli government do not practice the laws of the Torah. They imitate the goyim, unfortunately, try to go by the European and the American style. So it doesn't apply to our generation, but this is a mitzvah that applied in their time when they came to the land. Besides destroying all the idols, actually cleaning the holy land from this kind of people. Mitzvah number 426, not to have any mercy on the idols worshippers, which means, for instance, you're not allowed to say, what a nice Mr. Liz this guy is, what a nice, whatever his name is, he's such a nice person. Yeah, he's worshiping an idol, the fool, but, it's not such a bad person after all. He needs help, so I'm going to help him. Any kind of mercy to this kind of people is forbidden. It's a big sin. The Torah say, don't find them kind, don't find them nice, don't compliment, don't give them any gifts. Don't have mercy on them whatsoever. Even they're offering money, they're offering you anything you want, you're not allowed to have any mercy on them, because someone who worships an idol doesn't deserve to live. End of story. If you know, in some of my previous lectures, even though it always gets me into trouble and I get massive amount of complaints, I always warn from Jewish idol worshippers that we have in our time. We have Jewish idol worshippers. They're not as dumb to make a statue and worship the statue, but they're worshiping a rabbi. They say, never died, he's the God, he's the Messiah, you have to pray to him, all kinds of things like this. It's just as bad. There's really no difference. No difference whatsoever, even if they shomer Shabbos, even if they give tzedakah, even if they pray three times a day in minyan, they do kiddush, they put tefillin, they put talit, they walk with tzitzit, they keep the laws of modesty, whatever they do doesn't matter. If they're worshiping a person, any kind of person, even if the person was righteous. We're not talking that they're worshiping a wicked person. That's needless to say. Talking, they're worshiping Moshe Rabbeinu. They're worshiping Moses. Nobody was greater than him. They're worshiping him. That's already Avodah Zarah. You know, it's no permission in the Torah. We got to be very careful. I would tell you that you have to warn them from these horrible sins that they do, but from experience, it's just not going to work. Because I find it almost impossible to get them out of this bad habit. Once someone is in idol worshiping, is worshiping a man or a rabbi or anything, I find it very, very difficult to even talk to them. Their ears are blocked. This sin contaminates the soul so bad that a person is not even willing to listen. Any other sin, you come to a person, most of the time he's willing to listen. He's asking questions, he's challenging, he tried to prove his point. But with them, it's like talking to the wall. So this is it. You got to be very careful with this sin of Avodah Zarah. Mitzvah number 428, not to enjoy from any cover of idol worshiping. I'll give you an example. Let's say the Chinese, they made a special outfit for their Buddha, for his birthday. They made him an outfit, put him a nice hat, whatever, you know. And then it arrived to you and you want your son to put it for Purim as a custom, you know. So you say, well, it's a custom, it's a good custom. You know, it looks special, colors, all these kinds of things, not allowed to enjoy from it. Not allowed to make your dog wear it even. Any kind of pleasure from anything that covered an idol or any kinds of Avodah Zarah, not allowed to enjoy from it whatsoever. If an animal, for instance, they used it for Avodah Zarah, like the Hindus worshipping the cow, they fight in the street who's going to get the pee of the cow for breakfast with his cornflakes. You know, this is what's happening. You know, it sounds like a joke, but go to India and see what happens when the cow wants to cross the street. You worry about New York traffic. It may take you 5 hours. The cow is in the middle of the road. It's holy. It's Mother Nature, they say. Why it's holy? Ask them why it's holy. This is the answer you're going to get. Because the cow give birth in 9 months. It's like a woman, so it's holy. What's the connection? You got me. I don't know. There's really no connection. Anyway, so any kind of covering of Avodah Zarah, gold, silver, diamonds, bracelet they made. You say, in the middle of the night, I'll go into this Hindu temple and remove all this sapphire or rubies. It could be $1 million jewel. I'll go, I sell it, I give the money to the poor people in the synagogue. There's poor people, they can't find a job today. At least we do something good with these diamonds. The answer is it's filthy. Cannot ever use it. That's it. Was used for Avodah Zarah even 1 second. That's it. There's no way to enjoy from it. There's no way to replace it, exchange it, nothing whatsoever. Look, this is just showing you how horrible is that sin. That a person dare to participate with another God besides Hashem in any way. Okay? So mitzvah number 429. Not to put together any item of idols worshiping with your instruments or tools or money. For instance, if they take dollar bills, like I saw one time, They have a Buddha in their closet. They put flowers. They make him a chain, you know, and they put dollars. They put candles and they throw money. For whatever reason, they give him dollar. Maybe he needs coffee for the morning. I don't know. So they put money there. Now you want to take this money and you put it together with your wallet. It contaminates your own money also. Not only the filthy money you took that was used for an idol. You put it together with your money, it's a sin. You understand? Even if you want to deliver it to the Maharaji, you say you're on the way to India, I say, do me a favor. You collect all the things from the plate of Buddha, you know, and he said, take it, give it to the Dalai Lama, whatever his name is. On the way, they'll give it to him, and you want to put it in your pocket with your money, it's a sin from the Torah. Worse than eating pork. They give you pork, you won't eat. That's much bigger sin. Anything that connects to this idol worshipping is a very bad sin. The wigs, there was a whole thing about the wigs that they found out that Hindu women shave their head. They can't afford any sacrifice to their idols, so they shave their head. They put it in front of these big statues, and then they do not know what to do with that, so they sell it to the Italian designer, and they sell it for wig production, and they make wigs, and some of these wigs ended up on Jewish heads. And there was a whole thing about it. Later, they started to investigate, and they found out that it's not so simple. It was a false alarm. In the end, I don't really know all the details, but in the end, it wasn't as bad as it sounded in the beginning. Mitzvah number 430, the mitzvah of Birkat Hamazon. When a person eats, he has to bless God for the food that he gave him. Now, in general, everything that we eat and we become full from, which means if you eat 1 ounce of food within 4 to 6 minutes, 4 minutes to begin with, 6 minutes if it's stretched a little bit longer, up to 6 minutes, then it's considering that you got full from that food that you ate. Even if you're full for 2 minutes and then you become hungry again, but for that second that you finish eating, you felt not hungry anymore, you have an obligation from the Torah to bless Hashem. But we are talking only if you became full from bread. Anything else that it's not bread, it's rabbinical law. Which means, let me give you an example. If you ate 1 ounce of bread within 4 minutes, 1 ounce is one slice of rye bread, in case you don't know, or half a pita bread. So if you eat it within 4 minutes, and you were very hungry before, you're full now. You have an obligation to make the entire Birkat Hamazon, which takes about 3 minutes to do it, okay? What happened if you ate rice, 28 grams, which is 1 ounce of rice, few big spoons of rice, and you're also full? If it was up to the Torah, you don't have to make any blessing. But it's a rabbinical law that anything you eat, you make a blessing. But it's a lower level than eating bread. Because when the Torah is speaking about real meal, it comes with bread. Bread is the main food of a person. The bread, we are talking only bread that is made from the 5 kinds of grains. Not, for instance, if it's rice bread that was made from rice flour, then it's not bread. You know, but it's not one of the 5 kinds of grains. Wheat, barley, oat, this is the 5 kinds of grains. So if a person eats a bread that was made for that, then he has an obligation to do hamotzi, to wash his hands, to make first bracha hamotzi lechem min haaretz, and then when he finished the meal, to say the blessing on the bread. Now what happened if a person took one bite and waited 5-7 minutes, let's say? He took one bite, he went on the phone, somebody called him. Then he came back, he took another bite, and they had another phone. And then he took a bite, and he had another phone. Let's say he's a busy guy. He doesn't have time to sit and eat. Each one of the bites was 15 grams, half an ounce. If it goes like this all day, one bite, 7 minutes. One bite, 7 minutes. One bite, 7 minutes. He finished 2 loaves of bread, but he never became full. Because the half an ounce digests right away. And he never got to a point that he was full. He doesn't have to say last bracha. Not he doesn't have to. He's not allowed to. Because if he says it's mentioning the name of Hashem for no reason. only when he ate 1 ounce of bread within 4 to 6 minutes, as I said, and then the rest of the meal, it's not relevant. If you ate in one part of the meal, 1 ounce within 4 to 6 minutes, you are full, you must say Birkat HaMazon. The first three blessings of the Birkat HaMazon is from the Torah. The fourth one, which is all the request and the praising of Hashem, it's rabbinical bracha. The first part of Birkat HaMazon, Moshe Rabbeinu wrote. Moshe Rabbeinu tiken, I should say. The nosach is Anshe HaKnesset HaGdolah, but the obligation to say the first bracha, Hazan et hakol, Moshe Rabbeinu did when the man came down. And then the second one, it's Yoshua Benun, al haaretz ve'al hamazon. Bless you, God, for the land and for the food. Why Joshua made it? Because he was the one who entered the Jewish nation into the land. The third one, Bonei Yerushalayim, bless you, God, the builder of Jerusalem. King David and his son Solomon are the one who made that bracha of Bonei Yerushalayim. And then the fourth bracha, Anshe HaKnesset HaGdolah, the Knesset of the 120 chief rabbis and prophets that were sitting in Jerusalem, they're the one who added the fourth bracha, which is including any request that you can think of. Since the blessing of the food is the only blessing is from the Torah. Should know that. The most important prayer, believe it or not, is actually the Birkat HaMazon, when a person eats bread. This is an obligation from God to bless him for all this list. Any other prayer is rabbinical law. You have an obligation to pray to God. You can do it in your own language. If you don't know how to read, you're somewhere in Zimbabwe now on a mission, and you want to say, you want to pray. You don't have a book. You don't know what to do now. So what do you do? Dear God, I love you. Thank you for everything you give me. I appreciate it. Help me with this, help me with that. Help me to catch the flight. Help my wife to be healthy. Help this, help that. Help my grandfather. Help his neshama. He passed away. Whatever you want, anything. Help my children, open my brain. Help me to understand better. Give me a parnasa. I want to make a living. I want to find a job. I want to get accepted to yeshiva, I want to pass the test, whatever. There's millions of things you can talk to in your own language. It's count as a prayer, 100%, as God told you. But since people are foolish, and they do not know what to request, and sometimes they request poison, so the Knesset HaGdolah made a certain text that it applies to everyone. They put it in the right order for us to ask God in the most productive way. Once they set up the text, that's it. We're not changing from the text. We're not allowed to erase one word or to add. There are certain parts that we're allowed to add our own request, yes. But to erase one word from the prayers is not allowed. We have to say the entire prayer. But Birkat HaMazon, this is an obligation from the actual Torah. You should eat and be full and bless your God who gave you the land, the food. This is a verse in the Torah. So once you do it, because it's such a high level of blessing, the Chachamim, the sages, attached a list of things in the end. Look at the second part of Birkat HaMazon. After Bonei Yerushalayim, this entire page and a half of requests, Arachman Ishtabach al Kiseh Kvodo, God will be praised on his chair, God will praise in heaven, God will, all these lists, and then help us this, our business should be close to home, you send us health and wealth and all these things, you know, and then you bless, sometimes somebody buy you the food, he order the food for you in a restaurant, he pays it, then you have gratitude, you have to bless him for being the sponsor of the food. So there's a special guest blessing inside the meal that you bless the owner of the house who hosts you in his house and give you the food and butter to cook. So this is the blessing of the food, Birkat HaMazon. Now, anything else you eat, 1 ounce within 4 to 6 minutes, it's rabbinical obligation to make a bracha. For instance, if you eat, even though it's a big argument about it, some of the Chachamim say not only the five kinds of grain that you eat is an obligation from the Torah, also the seven kinds of special fruit that the Torah mentioned. Olives, grapes, a cake that is made from wheat or barley, or, you know, any one of the chita and seora. and pomegranates, if you have 1 ounce, and the dates. This is the list of the seven special. It's called Shivat Aminim. Some says that this is also an obligation from the Torah, because this is special food that the Torah mentioned by the name. The Torah didn't speak about peaches, about watermelons. Yeah, the nation of Israel, they complained that they missed the watermelons on Mitzrayim. But Hashem himself never spoke about the importance of the rest of the fruit and vegetables. But the seven kinds of special fruit is mentioned in the Torah have a significant, the importance. So according to some opinion, this is also an obligation from the Torah. But since we are not sure, we always go to the lenient. When it comes to blessing, we don't mention the name of Hashem many times for no reason, only when we're sure. So we make a shorter blessing, which is bracha me'en shalosh. There's a bracha that can be changed to three different texts. It could be ala michia, which is any kinds of wheat, barley, five kinds of grains. But it's not hamotzi. Anything that you didn't wash your hands and did hamotzi, you have five kinds of grain, like cookies, wafers, whatever, all these kinds of mezonot. So you make ala michia if you ate 1 ounce within 4 to 6 minutes. If you add the special fruit that is mentioned, pomegranate, dates, figs, that is mentioned in the Torah, so you say, ala aretz ve'al pri ha'etz, ala aretz ve'al ha'perot, the special fruit. And then if it's drinking wine or grape juice, you drink 86 grams, which is 3 ounces, 86 grams within in one shot. You drink it in one shot, it's 3 point something ounces. It's very small cup. You drink it in one shot, you have to say a blessing, ala aretz v'al pri ha'gefen. Then every other thing that you make a bracha shehakol, you know, like you make shehakol nia bidvaro, candies or drinking, all kinds of drinks besides grape. Any drinks that come from the grape tree, such as grape juice or wine, special drink. But all the other drinks, squeeze orange juice, apple juice, water, milk, any kind of liquid, it's always shehakol. Drinking it, you make borei nefashot rabot v'chesronan, short bracha. You're eating a lot of rice, lots of meat, lots of chicken, doesn't matter. Very short bracha. Borei nefashot rabot. Unless, if it comes, like I say, from the seven kinds that the Torah mentioned, then it's a special blessing. It's like a mini Birkat Amazon. Short Birkat Amazon. Baruch Ata Hashem, ala aretz, ala michia, ala kalkala. So we are now focusing on Birkat Amazon. And like I said, if a person would have complete focusing and attention when he read Birkat Amazon slow and pay attention to every word, is guarantee to make a living in a much easier way than what he has. This is a very big test. It's only 2.5-3 minutes. After a while, you know it by heart. It can even take 2 minutes. But the Satan will do everything he can to disturb your attention. Phone, noise, kids, the kid fell from the chair, begin to scream. Someone knock on the door for tzedakah. You find out there's always something. You understand? So you have to know that in the middle of Birkat Amazon, you don't move, you don't look around, you don't move things, you don't help to clean, you don't get up from the chair. You sit like you sit in front of a king and make the entire and have mind for every word. And like I said, this is the most important blessing that a person does to Hashem, because it's a direct obligation from the Torah. This was mitzvah number 430. Mitzvah number 431, to love the converts. To love the converts. How do you define loving? How do you define loving? If you go, you take 10 different individuals and ask them, what does it mean to love? Everyone would say something else. One say to give gifts. One say, well, you know how you know I love him? I know I'm not beating him up. Everybody else I beat up. But him I don't beat up. That's the sign that I love him. One other person say, I only talk good about him. One other person say, I help him in anything he needs. One other person say, you know what does it mean to love? To think about him all day. one another person say, you know what it means to love? To hug him and kiss him as much as I can. So people translate love sometimes in different ways. But we don't care what we think. We care what Hashem says. What does it mean to love the converts? To get them a job? To help them to convert? To accept them to the synagogue? To buy them clothes to wear? What does it mean to love them? So, not to upset them in any way. That's, now I'm reading to you what it means. Not to upset them in any way. To do as much as kindness and mercy that we can do for them. Help them in any way. Any help they need, you have to volunteer, to run, to help. Never to insult them. Never to remind them what they used to be. Hey, don't tell me what to do. A year ago, you bowed down to J.C. Penney. Now you're telling him what to do? That's a big sin from the Torah. I cannot talk to him like this. You cannot tell him, oh, you just came from Africa and now you became a rabbi. Tell us what to do. All kinds of things that may upset him. Even he may doesn't pay attention, but you don't know. You're taking a big risk. You upset him. It's in the same category of the widow and the orphans, that the punishment is much bigger when you upset a normal person. If you upset a widow or an orphan or a convert, that's a separate punishment. It's a different league. You're playing with much bigger bomb. You upset a normal person is a little granite. You upset him is an atomic bomb. You have to think a million times before you deal with that. Okay? And of course you should love him like a normal brother, like a Jew from birth. You can never deceive him in words and in business and in money. Well, we understand the logic behind this obligation that Hashem always have special mercy on miserable people. A widow lost her husband. He was taking care of her, supporting her, buying her what she needs, helping her in the house. She always knew that I have someone to rely on. Now she lost him. She needs much more help than before. So Hashem has mercy on her. If somebody comes and take advantage on her, then gets a God very angry, much angrier than before. Even before he gets angry, when she's not a widow. But now a lot more, because you have the nerve to take a miserable person and bury him even more than what he's buried. Oh, that's already crossing a red line. Same thing the orphans. You know, we're not talking someone who's 60 years old, his father 85 years old, passed away, and he said, I'm an orphan. 60 years old, he has grandchildren already. That's not an orphan. An orphan means a person that's still not independent. He's not married, he's not out of the house. He lived by the house and one of his parents died. That's an orphan, he's young. You know, he needs his father or mother, he lost them, it's a problem. And the converts, they leave their family, their parents, their biological family, they leave their environment, society, sometimes they move from different place, they lose their job, whatever the point is, they do not know anything, they don't have confidence, they always worry what people will say by looking at me, I'm doing the wrong thing, I don't know how to stand, I don't know what to do, when to rise, when to sit, how to dress, what to say. So many things that occupy their mind, they don't need your hassle, they have enough. So come and make their life a lot easier. Invite them for Shabbat, show them what, tell them anything you need, anytime, you call me. If he comes to ask for tzedakah, a Jew come, you give him whatever you normally give. If you find out he's a convert, you have to give him more, even a little more. That's showing Hashem, I'm listening to you. You see, I give every Jew that comes in the door $20. I found that he's a convert, I gave him 30, just for that. That's exactly what the Torah is talking about. Mitzvah. But one more comments I want to make about converts. Today we have a serious problem. We can divide the converts to two different sides, two different categories. We have the real converts that came only for the truth of the Torah. They heard lectures, somebody gave them a CD. Accidentally they participated in a place that the rabbi gave a speech. They saw a show on television about Judaism. They took books from the library. They have a friend at work that is a religious Jew, and they're jealous how he lives. They see they one time came to his house for some party that he has, and they saw how the Jews live according to the Torah. And it triggers something in their soul, and they come for the truth, and then they accept all the laws of the Torah with no exception, and they live like Orthodox Jews. Those are the kosher converts that the Torah speaks about. However, we have many fake ones. They never had any intention to convert. They only did it because of relationship with a Jewish boy or a Jewish girl. They met them, they fell in love with them, fell in love, deep in love. And the guy tells her, hey, dear Christine, you know, I love you, everything is fine, but I can't marry you. My father will kill me, I'll lose my family, I can't do it. No, no problem, I'll convert for you. You just tell me what to do. She cares about the Torah? If it will be Ahmed, she'll be Muslim. It will be the Maharaji in India. She become an Indian. She put a dot here like this, no problem. You know, what does she care about religion? She wants to live with this Jew that she loved. She met him in a club. You know, or the other way around. It could be a girl, Jewish girl, and the goy wants her. I'll do anything you want. That's fake converts. That's not real converts. This is Giur L'Shem Yishut. Sometimes they convert because they want to get a job. And the only way to work for this kind of people is to come and pretend you're religious, so they do it. Sometimes they have a business in a religious area. They know if they put a yarmulke on, it brings more customers. Because this is the nature of the Orthodox Jews. They would rather buy from their brothers than strangers. You know, I know someone, he comes, yarmulke even grew his sideburns. You know, right? To look religious, he has a store in Bnei Brak. As soon as he gets in a car, he drives half a mile out of Bnei Brak, right away he takes the yarmulke, finally I can breathe, big deal. This is all fake. So there are fake ones. How do you know who's fake? You see right from the beginning. Yesterday she was in a mikveh, today she walks to the beach with bikini. What convert is this? Oh, she eats by McDonald's. Oh, what are you doing, Sarah? Or perhaps Christine. What happened? What are you doing in McDonald's? No, I had to use the bathroom. The next day you catch her again there. What happened? Also bathroom? You see that she's not religious. Now we are not talking one, a convert, once in a while he make a scene. We all make scenes. We're talking in general. She's modest all the time. Once in a while she doesn't know the halacha, maybe it's too short. No, fine. She's a Jew. She made a scene. She speaks Lashon Hara. Almost everyone speak. We are talking now, she accepted the foundation of the Torah or no? Or the Goy? Yes or no? If no, he can claim that he's a Jew forever. It's not going to help. In Shamayim, he's 100% a Goy. Those kind of fake ones, we have no obligation to love them, to help them, to ask them for what they need, nothing whatsoever, because they're 100% Goyim. We still have an obligation to respect every Goy. As I spoke in my intermarriage lecture, I explained for about 10, 15 minutes that a Jew has to respect every human being, not to harm them in any way, not to deceive them, not to cheat them. If they're not idols worshiper, you have to love them. Rabbi Chaim Vital, right? You have to love them. But we're talking different kind of love. Love, which means if he dies, I feel bad for him. If he lost his job, I feel bad for him. He had an accident or something, or got divorced. He works by me, by my office. I feel bad for him. He's a non-Jew, but I feel bad for him as human being to human being. But I don't have the obligation to love him like I love my brother. This was only to Jews. Ve'avta le'reacha kamocha, and converts even more than biological from birth Jews. Mitzvah number 432. Fear from God, not like some of the rabbis in this generation, they try to bury this mitzvah very deep in the ground. Don't talk about fear, only love, love. We don't like to say the bad things. We don't like to talk about punishment. We don't like to say the how strict is God. You don't like, you like, who cares? We go by what the Torah say. The Torah means a person should have fear from God every second of his life, not to make any sin. If he has fear from God, the chance that he will make sins is very small. If he never heard about the concept of fearing God, because he went to a place that they only talk about illusions and love, he makes a sin every hour, every minute. But he lives in a dream that he's in love with God, and you know, but really in reality he has no fear, because he never understands the concept of punishment, how severe is the punishments of God. You don't need me. Read Deuteronomy, read Dvarim. See the list of the punishments that God promised to the wicked Jews and the wicked Goyim. Read. And then you come back to me and tell me if I exaggerate or not. If I exaggerate to the lenient side, not to the strict side. It's much worse than what I say. I try to do it, make it look a little bit nicer. Bottom line, you don't want to play with fire, definitely not against Hashem. You want to be ungrateful, you pay a very heavy price. You want to be mechalel Shabbat, you lose your Judaism, you lose your share to the world to come. You want to eat non-kosher, it contaminates your soul. It will affect you in any other part of your life. You want to be a bad husband, you want to be a cheater, you want to be a crook, you're going to pay big time. Yeah, don't be surprised that sicknesses are coming and every other person has cancer and so much bankruptcies and problem and depression. This is 100% a result of our behaving. Don't let anyone fool you. Nothing is coincidence. It's not coincidence that every other person now have cancer. It's not coincidence. It's not coincidence that 1 out of 8 women have breast cancer. It's not coincidence. The modesty of the lady is so bad. That's what happened to them. They live in fear all the time. Everything, they feel something right away. They're panicking. They have to wait a month until the doctor accepts them to an appointment. And that month, they go crazy. Hashem wants them to be like this. Why? You betrayed me. You ignore me. You don't care about my instruction. I make your life hell on earth. This is it. You don't want to listen. You pay the price. I don't owe you anything. I give you food because I don't want you to die yet, but I really don't owe you. You have a place to sleep. I don't owe you that also. You can be homeless, freezing, making fire by the garbage and freeze all night. You have a place to sleep, even though you go against me every second of your life. Don't be too happy. The bill will come later. You understand why your friend is sleeping in a park, freezing, covering himself with carbon paper, doesn't have a place. One day is on this bench, one day sleeping in the hallway of some building, and you still have a place and a car, and you drive, and you have a nice, successful business. Why? He deserves this, and you deserve this? No. Your time will come. It will be much worse than his. But I'm still waiting for you. He started already to get his punishment. All these things is called Yirat Hashem, but there's two kinds of fear from Hashem. There's fear that comes from respect. You know, this is the most important person in the world, so you have automatically respect. And when he talks, you don't dare to talk. If he talks to you, you won't dare to answer your phone. If your friend talks to you, you don't care. You pick up the phone and say, hold on. But if somebody important comes, the president, the biggest rabbi, the professor from your, whatever, you know, people that you admire, so you automatically have some kind of extra respect for them. This is the obligation. But also the Zirat HaOnesh, the fear from the punishment. And King Solomon wrote, nobody knows better than him. He knew all the secrets except the red cow. But all the secrets of God he knew. We have no understanding what we're talking here about. And he wrote in 2 different places, in hundreds of places. But I'm quoting 2 now. Sof davar hakol nishma, in the end, everything will be heard. Fear God and keep his commandments, because this is what all human being is all about. Nothing else. No success, no career, no hobbies, no vacation, no nothing. One thing, it's success. Fear God and don't make mistake. Listen to him that later you don't have to pay the price. Who said it? The wealthiest person, the most handsome person, the smartest person ever lived, the king of the world, what else do you want? Anybody tasted more than him from what this world has to offer? He wrote, I tried everything, I did everything. Conclusion, don't waste your time on it. Bottom line, fear God and listen to him, because this is why you were created to begin with. Don't do anything else, just this. And in another place he wrote, Ashrei Adam Mefachet Tamid. Ashrei means the luckiest. Adam means human being, even a goy. Goy also have mitzvot to keep and reward and punishment. Ashrei Adam Mefachet Tamid. Who is a lucky person? A person who always, always have fear from God. Today, this is what the people say. Rabbi, I cannot be religious. It's too much stress, too much fear. all the time, allowed, not allowed, punishment, I operate with fear, it's too much for me, I can't take it. What is it like? A person says, you know, there's fire and fire is burning. So he's complaining now that the fire is burning. I can't take it. What do you mean? It's reality. It's the law of nature. Fire can help, fire can burn you. The sins can make you a much bigger damage than the fire. The fire can take away 10 years of your life, 20, 30, and it's over. The sins can take your eternity away. You understand? So the point is, King Solomon wrote, Ashrei Adam Mefachet Tamid. The more you fear God, the less sins you do. There's no other way. No other way. Everywhere Hashem told us to love him, right next to it he wrote, and to fear him. To love me and to fear me. It's true that love comes first. And I wish that most people would be able to become religious and close to Hashem with love only, without having to talk about punishments and fear. But it's not the case. And you know, they say, En chacham kebaal nisayon. No one is wiser than someone with experience. And I'm talking to you from the books and from life experience. After 16 and a half years that I deal with people, I saw what works, what doesn't work. Once in a blue moon, you find a very special soul that by speaking to me about the beauty of the Torah, he wakes up and becomes very religious. Very rare. Usually people only wake up when they know that there's a heavy price to pay, and if you don't do it, you're going to pay the price. And sometimes it takes a year or two until they get convinced that the price will come. Why? God sent them a reminder. Accident, bankruptcy, divorce, cancer, maybe cancer, MRI, next week the answer is coming. Oh, now they wake up. In a hospital, almost everyone is religious. Why not to be religious before going to the hospital? One guy had he crossed the street and a car came and hit him. And he went to the hospital. After a week he came out, you know, he has a cast, nothing major. So he made a meal in a shul, in a synagogue, for all the people in the morning. He brought cakes, food, bread, cheese, fish, whatever. He made a nice breakfast. So the rabbi asked him, what's the occasion? He had a kid, a baby, something. He said, no, I had a bad accident. I was in a hospital for a week. Baruch Hashem, I came out yesterday, so I'm making a meal to thank God I didn't die. Could have been a much worse case. So everyone say, oh, l'chaim, mazal tov, thank you, be healthy, no problem. The next day, another guy from the shul also make a meal, breakfast. So the rabbi said, what happened to you? Also had an accident. He said, no, that's exactly the point. That's why I'm having a meal. 20 years I cross the same street like he does. 20 years I cross the street every day and a car never hit me. Why did I only have to thank God after the car hit me and I didn't die? I thank him that no car hit me. But I take it for granted until I realize yesterday when happened to him, now I realize it could have happened to me. It didn't happen to me. I owe you a lot. 20 years, cars coming, trucks, like Queens Boulevard. You know, those major avenues, cars are coming. It's very, very difficult. So I thank God that I never got hurt. You understand? But the idea is most people don't do it before. They only wake up when it's sometimes even too late. So this is it. Now, let's read some of the things. This mitzvah is Et Hashem Elokecha Tira. Fear your God. Where does it say it? Deuteronomy 6, verse 13, verse 10, verse 20. It appears a few times. Et Hashem Elokecha Tira. Fear your God. Okay, and then it says like this. It's applied to every man, male and female, all time, anywhere, all over the world. It never stopped for a minute. Even to non-Jews, it applies. But we are now talking about the 613 commandments. You understand? So, a person must keep in mind that God is watching me every second of my life and recording me, video and audio. And in the end, everything will be displayed in the time of my death. So if I think that I'm doing something in hidden rooms and nobody see me, think again. Hashem sees you everywhere. You cannot hide under the bed, under the blanket, in a bathroom, under the ground, in a grave. You hide whenever you want. God is watching you. You cannot run away from him. Yonah the prophet, he sent him to Nineveh. He was hiding from God. He hoped not to go. It's not going to help him. No matter where you're going to run, it's not going to help. It can only make the situation much worse, thinking Hashem is not watching. Mitzvah number 433, it's mitzvah to pray every day to God. How many times? Once. From the Torah, one prayer, one time a day. You choose how long you want to talk to him. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 5 hours, it's up to you. The more, the better. The more, the better. Of course, the more you do the mitzvah, the more it's... But if, whatever reason, you couldn't talk today, and you just talk to God 5 minutes, you're standing like this, and you talk to him, you're driving your car, you talk to him, you sit in your bed, you talk to him, whatever the case is, from the Torah, you fulfill your obligation. As I said before, today it's not enough. Today you have 3 times a day, morning, afternoon, evening. Shachrit, Mincha, Arvit. Yom Kippur 5 times. Shachari Arvit of the night before. Shachrit, Musaf, Mincha, and Neila. 5. That's why the way why the Arabs pray 5 times a day, 5 minutes each time. 5 minutes, because they're in a rush to drive their yellow cab right away. The cabs are double park in 96th Street there. So, you know, they got to come quickly. If they stay like us, an hour and a half in a shul, you know what would happen? They'll find all the cabs with flat tires. People have to come out. They park. So why they do it 5 times every day? Everything the Arabs do is a cheap imitation of what the Jews did 2,000 years before Islam started. Don't ever let them fool you that they're more religious. Baloney. They only copy what the Jews did and try to do the same thing better. The problem by them is that they don't understand what's divine and the depth of everything that we do. And they think that if the Jews pray on Yom Kippur, which is the holiest day of the year, 5 times, we will show them what we better. We'll pray every day 5 times. Or if the Jewish woman is covered from head to toe with skirts, with white clothes, nothing is short, cut, tight, so we will do the same, but we will show them that we better. The ladies will also cover their face. And we will show them that we more modest. By then, the ladies are covered, at least 1,400 years ago, that's how it was. You never find a Jewish woman that can show parts of her body. It was all covered. So we will show them that we're even covering the face, that you cannot even see the beauty of the face of the woman, which is a higher level of modesty. They made one mistake. They didn't know that God said not to cover the face. The face must stay open. They didn't know that part. So God said, panim means inside in Hebrew. It shows who you are. Your spirituality comes out from your eyes, from your face. You can look at the eyes of a person and see if he's a murderer or not, if he's a merciful person, if he's an honest person. By looking at his face, his images, when he talks, you can know a lot about him. Depend who you are, of course. Not everyone see it, but you can see right away. You can see who's a Jew, who's not a Jew. You can see many things. By covering the face, you cannot see anything. Which woman covered her face in the Torah? Tamar. She was pretending that she's a prostitute. Why? Prostitute covered her face. That's what the Torah say. Only the prostitute covered her face. Why? Because they don't want anyone to know that you come. Excuse me, how are you? You don't know she's your cousin. She's covered. Well, if she would be open, everyone know about her. People would have a shame. Not like today, the prostitute come on a stage on primetime television and get a car for the prostitution. You understand? The world was different. If a woman chose to do such a dirty thing, she makes sure nobody will know it's her. That's why the prostitute used to cover their face. But a modest woman, she doesn't need to cover her face. It's enough that her body is covered, and that's it. However, the men, is not supposed to stare in her face when he talks to her. Kosher man doesn't stand like this and look at her like this when he talks. You look briefly, and that's it, and you talk. You don't have to focus, right? The more you look, the more your thoughts begin. So this is the mitzvah to pray. Ve'avadtem et Hashem Elokechem. You worship your God. The Oral Torah explained, what does it mean to worship God? Avodah Shebalev. Worshipping directly from the heart. What does it mean to worship him from the heart? The answer is to pray to him every day. The more you pray, the better it is. Okay? So, talking to Hashem is an honor. It's a privilege. It's not a punishment, like some people think. Now, mitzvah number 434, to stick to the scholars of the Torah. To stick to the rabbis, to stick to the holy people, to stick to people that live according to the Torah. It's not, I'm lucky. My uncle is a big rabbi, so I have the merit to drive him and to learn from him. No, if your uncle is not like this, your cousin is not like this, if your father is not like this, if your brother is not like this, you have to search for someone like this. Even a stranger, doesn't matter. Rabbi, can I be close with you? Do you need anything? Can I drive you? Why you want to drive him? Besides the fact that it's a mitzvah to help any Jew who drives, it's a chesed. To drive him, it's like showing Hashem, you know why I'm doing it? Because I respect you. I respect your Torah. This is your messenger here. He teach your Torah. He learn your Torah. You love him more than other people. So by me helping him, I show you how much I love you. It's like your son. I help the son of the king. The king appreciates it. It's a sign that I love the king, right? If I save the prince from drowning, the king is holding it forever to my favor. Wow, he saved my son. I have a special entry for him. I have a VIP entry. I don't have to wait online. I can call his cell phone. Why? Why did I get that? Because I saved his son. The messenger of God is the Chachamim of the Torah, not people with college degrees. They have no credits in Shamayim, in heaven, nothing whatsoever. Only credits in learning Torah and practicing the Torah. Torah is not a history or math that you come to college and teach and go back, no. Torah, if you don't live according to it, what's the point? Teach about the beauty of Shabbat, then they find him on a beach on Shabbat. Like the Reforms or the Kabbalah Center, all this nonsense. Comes to give a lecture in Manhattan, from Queens, with a car on Shabbat, 5 o'clock, gets in the car, drive back home. It's teaching about Kabbalah, the secrets of Shabbat, the light, the seven heavens, and then gets in the car and drive and eat pig with melted cheese for breakfast in a bagel store before he arrive. What's all this nonsense? Kabbalah. Baloney. It's all crooks. Money-making machines. All the big rabbis, include the biggest Kabbalists in the world, wrote a letter against these crooks that it's worse to enter to their buildings and lectures worse than entering the church. You should know that. You know, buying their books, giving them power, donating money to them, it's a horrible sin. For every dollar you get a punishment. You understand? You can tell it to what's her name, the singer. She gave them many millions. That's okay. She made the millions in a non-kosher way, so Hashem made it go to this kind of people. She was making it in a kosher way, with modesty and real kosher job, it would go to the right places. When the money comes from all kinds of garbage work and forbidden things, that's where it ended up, in the pocket of all these crooks and filthy, tmeim, impure people that modify the Torah, as long as they can make money and get their fame and glory. Right? So this is it. So sticking to Chachmei HaTorah. Gadol Shimusha Yoter Milimuda. Who is going to be a greater rabbi? Someone who is close with a great rabbi, he learns less Torah in yeshiva. But he's stuck to Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul 10 years. See him in the morning, see how he wake up, how he wash his hands, how he sit to eat, how he talks, how he opens the books, how he takes advantage on his time, how he answers questions all day to people, how people, he always standing next to him. People ask questions, life and death, surgeries, this, birth, the doctor, abortions, all kinds of things. And every day, hundreds of things he hears, 10 years, 12 years, 15 years, he would know to become a much better rabbi than someone who was only book smart. Learning 20 years in yeshiva, it's very simple. It's like this by the doctors. Which one would be a better surgeon? Someone who learned 10 years in university, in medical school, he knows by heart everything about surgery, but he never performed or saw a doctor performing a surgery. Never. He only knows it by learning it in college, in the books. That's all. Or one that learned 5 years, not 10 years, 5 years medicine, but is already 5 years working next to the best surgeon in the world, his assistant in a surgery room. Who do you want to operate on somebody that you know? The first one who's 10 years learning medicine, but doesn't have experience, or 5 and 5? 5 years learning, 5 years working in a surgery room with the greatest surgeon. Who would you want to give you advice about the surgery? Huh? 5 and 5, if not, you're a fool. Who would agree that a person that learned all his life medicine but never performed anything in action to perform on his brain, to open the head, in the middle he gets stuck because he never saw how it's done. This is it. So when you stick to the Chachamim, you learn things that you don't read in the books. The books doesn't have the answer to millions of different scenarios that happen by the minute. There are scenarios in life that you need shikul dat. Someone who knows the entire Torah knows when to separate. Why to this guy say yes, to this guy no, for the same question. There's a lot to know. Believe me, I tell you, the more you are close to a chacham, the more you learn about life. And if you learn a lot in the books, no, you know, but not enough. This is what the Torah says. So that's why the Torah say you have to stick to your God. The Gemara asks, how can someone stick to God? It's a fire. You burn right away. You cannot see him and stay alive. How can you stick to God? We are material, and God is a superpower, perfect, complete spiritual superpower. We and him can be stuck together? How can you even imagine such a thing? The Gemara say, yes, there's a way to do it. Sticking to the rabbis, to the kosher one, being with them all the time, learning every shiur of them, never miss. Come, ask question before, ask answer, sending telephones, emails, whatever, coming for him for Shabbos if you can. Push yourself. When it comes to this, don't be embarrassed. That's the only way to become big yourself. Then it's count like you stick to Hashem. If you sponsor him, you give him your 10%, your maaser, then you become a partner in everything he does. He washes his hand in the morning, it's your mitzvah. Why? Without you, he'll be dead. He buys food, he has a bed, he pays his electric bill. Whatever he has, it comes from your money. So every mitzvah he does, you have a share in it. Think about it. Instead of wasting your money on nonsense, now at least your money goes to a holy cause. What's better, that it's going to go to Mechalel Shabbos who eat cheeseburger on Shabbat morning on Queens Boulevard, sitting there in a restaurant? It's better to help someone like that. It's better to help a crook. It's better to help someone who has a non-modest girlfriend, 15 in his notebook, to give him money that he has enough to buy perfume and a new tuxedo that he can go and make scenes. Who do you want to help? Huh? Who do you want to help? Think about it. The soccer player who play on Shabbat and 20,000 people come to see him how he kicks the ball and everyone cry, wow, what a goal. I can't, wow, for 1 week, cannot sleep. We miss the championship. Who, you want to send someone to college that he can smoke drugs and eat pizza with pepperoni at 2 o'clock at night with Christine and drink some beer? This is what you, I send my nephew to college, Rabbi. It's a big mitzvah, right? You'll see when you come to heaven what a big mitzvah it was. When you see what he did thanks to you in college over there. You understand? Of course, there's always exception to the rule. There are some good kids who go to college and they still watch their eyes with the yarmulke, and they're not making scenes. I'm not saying no, but what are the odds? Let's put a candy camera one day, and then we'll see who's right, me or people who disagree. No, I hope they're right. I'll be very happy to know that it's possible to be there and not make scenes. I know one thing. If I'd be in college 4 or 5 years, I don't think I would be able to stay religious that long. About myself, I'm saying. Maybe I'm a weak character, I don't know. I wouldn't be able to sit with all these goyot sitting next to me like this, that, we're talking, showing things, opening the... I wouldn't be able to. As much as you want. You're a human being. You're not a machine. If it wouldn't affect you, maybe something is wrong about you. Maybe you're an angel. Cannot be a person. You know? If it doesn't affect you, we have to check who you are. Maybe you're the Mashiach. Mitzvah number 435, to swear in the name of God when it's necessary. When is it necessary? When the Jewish court asks you to hold the Torah and swear in the name of God that you don't have your friend's money in your hand. Your friend claims he gave you money, you claim you don't have it. The court tell you, you have to swear. Or you say, I gave him 50 back, I only owe him 50. And he say, no, he's lying. He didn't give me anything back. I still have my entire 100. Since you admitted that you have half of what he claimed, you have to swear for the rest also. There's requirements when you're allowed to swear, when not. So your friend gave you a cow to watch, and he went to Israel, and he came back after a month, and the cow is gone. So you tell him, I tell you the truth, robbers came in the middle of the night, they broke the gate, and they stole my cows with your cows. What do you want me to do? I also lost mine. So what is the halacha? You don't have to give him money. You put it, it was locked, you did everything. They broke in, it's not your problem. You're only a keeper. You don't have to stay all day with a gun, watch his cow. You keep it in a normal way. However, since there's no witnesses, maybe you're lying. Maybe you left the gate open. Maybe you forgot the cow in the lake for a week, and then by the time you remember, she was dead already. How do we know? So therefore, he said, no problem. You don't want to pay me? Let's go to the Beit Din. You have to swear that you did not do any crime. You did not neglect the keeping. You kept according to the requirements of the Torah, and you don't have to give me. So he has to swear in the name of God. If he swear in a lie, oh, what a special grill they prepare for him in Olam Haba. A complete gyro that will never end. This is the violation of the Ten Commandments. It's not a joke. Which one? The third commandment. First one is the most important one. I'm the God that took you out of Egypt. Without this, there's nothing. What comes the next one? Don't ever dare to have another God. Not son of God, not the idol, not the sun, not the moon, and not the rabbi. None of them is God, only me. And the third one, do not dare to swear on a false testimony in the name of God. And the fourth one, the eternal covenant between God and the Jewish nation to keep the Sabbath. So you see that it goes from the most important to a little bit less important, less. But the top four, it's the foundation of everything. Should not lie. In the fault, because then that's it. Everyone will do whatever they want. If they can't, they lie in the name of God. That's why they subject to a horrible punishment. You know what the punishment is? That even repentance won't help them. That's the only thing in the Torah that the Torah says, Ki inake lo inake. Hashem will not clean this from your file, that sin. That's it. You did it, you are in very serious problem. You understand? So this is swearing in the name of Hashem when it's permitted. When it's permitted, the Torah says, "Ubishmo tishaveh." Yeah, they swear in His name when they require you to do it. And it applies to all Jews, male and female, right? And the mitzvah number 436. Mitzvah to destroy anything who relates and connects to idol worshiping. Also the idols themselves, it's needless to say. But anything, they put a tree, they put an umbrella to protect that idol. They put a special stage that they put the idol on it. They put all kinds of beauty things, things that make smells, stairs to go up to the stage. Everything that connects to this idol, you're not allowed to leave even one of it in the world. It's that bad that when you destroy the idols or the stages that they make, you have to dig it deep in the ground to take anything that makes impression in the area. Plus, even if there was furniture in the room, the furniture are contaminated from this idol worshiping. That's why it's very dangerous. People don't think about it because it doesn't say it too much in the books. It's very dangerous to buy things from Chinese or Korean people or Hindus that bow down to all kinds of idols because their filthy tum'ah, the impurity that they do in their house, stick to everything in the house. You wear their clothes, you wear their furniture, their table, their plates, whatever you get from them, everything is cursed. Why? Because Hashem cannot stand anything with idols. You see that it gets him very angry. Gets God very angry. You want to wear a suit of the Maharaji from India that 2 days ago used that suit to kiss the feet of his Buddha? You're now wearing it? You come to shul? Shalom Aleichem. He wears it. 2 days ago, this was in the filthiest place on earth. Now somehow he bought it used in a store. Doesn't know who was wearing it. If Mustafa was wearing it, fine. He screamed to the same Allah. Allahu Akbar is our God. Allah comes from the word El. It's an Hebrew word. They just added the A, which is the Hay of Hashem. But that's it. At least it's not idol worshiping. Then, so mitzvah to destroy any idols, any buildings of the idols, the churches as well. Why we don't destroy the churches? Because we're afraid to go to jail. But if it was in Israel and the Israeli government would live according to the Torah, no Christian would allow to do one Christian thing in Israel. All these churches that you see in Jerusalem, they wouldn't allow it. But they are weak. They themselves are big sinners. How do you expect one sinner to tell the other sinner, I don't give you permission to sin? It's like a father come to his son, don't lie. 2 minutes later, Abba, Moshe wants you on the phone. Shh, I'm not here. Just 2 minutes ago, he said, I don't allow you to lie. It's, you know, that judge, that goy judge that was beating up his daughter with the belt. Did you hear about it or no? Some judge. Yeah, a Christian judge in a court. Judge in a court. His girl, he was killing her with the belt. Mamash, slapping her nonstop, cursing, going crazy. Him and his wife also. For what? That she did something in her computer that she was not allowed. She downloaded something from the internet that they don't allow her to. You know, they give her limitation on a computer. So now, as revenge, she put that video on YouTube.
When they
hit her. And you hear that now the judge was about to get promoted to a very high level, I don't know, Supreme Court or higher court. And obviously it's going to finish his career. How can someone like this judge, when every second word is F this, F this, this is the entire video for 10 minutes. Somebody send me an email of that. This is the judges of United States. So somebody like this, can he give us now ethics? Worse than a dog. You understand? Imagine you stand in front of him and he sentenced you to 20 years in prison. Right away, your lawyer come and say, objection. This is worse than animal. How can he send a person to jail? He's supposed to be in jail. It's a problem here. You understand? If he's smart, he will resign. Resign. You know? So the idea is that we have to understand that in Israel, there's no permission to allow it 1 second. Gotta be destroyed. You live in America. You are a guest here. What can you tell them? This is their beliefs. They make themselves churches. They come and worship JCPenney. And this is their problem. You can talk to them. You can send them a copy of the debate. You can open up their eyes. It may work, it may not. There's nothing you can do. But in Israel, different story. Different story. Mitzvah la'abed avodah zarah, to destroy it. Mitzvah number 437, not to erase the name of God in any way. If you have a book, you're not allowed to erase the name of God from the book. You're not allowed to enter it to the bathroom if the name of God written in the ancient Hebrew. You're not allowed to erase the name of God that was written in any other way. And of course, when it's written in a Sefer Torah, it's a much bigger sin. by erasing it. If you write mezuzah and by mistake, you made a mistake, that's it. Why? You have to go back all the way to the mistake. You have to erase all the letters that you continue. You have to go back in reverse to erase everything to where the mistake is, fix the mistake and continue. But if you have the name of Hashem, the name of God, then you cannot erase the name of God. So you walk for 2 hours, you have to bury the mezuzah or the tefillin. You can walk 8 hours, and you just found out it's not kosher, there's nothing you can do. Why? You're not allowed to erase the name of God. I once told a story that in Israel, there are two neighbors. One bought a new car, and the other one is killing himself from jealousy. All day, see? Moshe, what are you doing by the window all day? Eating my heart. Why? Itzik bought a new car. All day suffering by the window because his neighbor have a nice car. So what did he do? In the north, in the south, there is sometimes sandstorm. Sands coming all over and cover the entire car. So he knew this guy that bought the car is religious. So he said, let me do a trick on him. I'll write the name of God on the hood, on the sand. So he went, Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey. He say, now he won't be able to drive the car anymore. Because if he drive the car, he will erase the name of God. The sand will spill, move, and that's like erasing the name of God. So as soon as this guy came out, Itzik, did you see what people did to your car? What is this? Somebody wrote the name of God. He cannot move now. Wow, I have a meeting. What's going to be now? I'm telling you, you cannot move the car. Ask your rabbi. Rabbi, what can I do? He said, well, he's right. You cannot erase the name of God. So I'm never going to move the car anymore? What am I going to do? I cannot clean the sand away. It's the name of God there. He say, you have to wait that it rains. It rains, fine. Or maybe the kids, they come, if you get lucky, they climb on a hood, they move it. Once it's erased, that's it. But you, to move the car, you can't. This is very serious. To erase the name of God is serious. In computers, it doesn't count writing. Even though you see writing on a screen, it's only lights. It's not really writing. So that's why if you press delete or you move from one screen to another, it's not considering erasing the name of God. If you re-record on a tape, that's the rabbi said the name of God many times in a tape, even with the right name, like let's say he reads from Tehillim and the name of God appear, if you erase it, it's no problem. It's a tape. It's not really writing. We are now only talking writing. All right? So we're not allowed to write any name of God, not only Yud, Hey, Vav, and Hey. Elohim, Yud, Hey, Shin, Daled, and Yud. All these names, the holy names, no permission to burn it, to erase it. In any way, is no permission to do it. Mitzvah number 438, to sacrifice all the obligation sacrifices when a person make a donation. Now, let me explain. Some sacrifices we spoke about in the past, you don't have a choice. You, by mistake, violated Shabbat. Now you have to bring Korban Chatat. Nobody asks you. You must. You don't do it, it's another violation. What happened if you had a baby girl? And you're happy after 17 boys, Baruch Hashem, one girl you have. So you're so happy, you want to thank Hashem. So you want to bring a sacrifice, and your sacrifice to Hashem is like a gift, as donation. So if you say that you're going to give it, what happened in that case? When the regel come, when the first holiday, one of the three festivals is coming, right? You have to bring it by then. Don't wait for the next one and the next one and the next one. You have to bring right away. Today, it's the same thing when you buy aliyah in a shul. People buy aliyah and then they wait 10 months until they pay it. Better to pay it right away. If you have the money, for sure, right away. Don't let holidays go, another one and another one. Pay. Now, definitely by Rosh Hashanah, you must clear all your debt to the shul, whatever you owe to the shul. You have commitments, you promised, whatever the case is, it's similar to the sacrifices. That's called a vow that a person makes. Mitzvah number 439, not to sacrifice anything from the sacrifices out of the place called the Azara in Bet HaMikdash. When you enter, there's a big place, it's called Azara. If you do things outside of it, it's a sin, not allowed. Right? That's called Bachutz. Yishamer lecha pen ta'ale olotecha bekol makom asher tireh. You cannot make a stage in your neighborhood and sacrifice to Hashem, like they used to do before Bet HaMikdash was built. In the time of Bilam, Balak, they made stages. Eliyahu Anavi, all these things, they make stages. Moshe and Korach, when they make the sacrifice and Hashem say, let's say who Hashem is going to take. Cain and Hevel, that's no problem. That's before the Bet HaMikdash was built. Once it's built, you have to do everything inside. You cannot do whenever you want. I'm lazy, I'll do it in Tel Aviv. I have to go all the way out to Yerushalayim. No, you got to do it where Hashem say to do it. Mitzvah number 440. It's to sacrifice all the sacrifices in Bet HaMikdash and not outside. Before, he was talking not to do it out of the Azara, right? Over here, it's an obligation, positive mitzvah, to do it inside Bet HaMikdash. The same thing, once as a positive, once as a negative. Do not do it out of Bet HaMikdash. Do it inside Bet HaMikdash. The same thing. But if you do it, you punish twice. For violation and for restriction and for not keeping a positive mitzvah. Two separate things, one transaction, two sins. You understand? So imagine you do such a thing, your father tell you, don't eat this food in the street. Don't embarrass me, eat in the street. And then he say to you, eat it inside the house. And then you didn't listen to him. You ate it in the street. And he said, now I'm giving you two punishments. You tell him for what? He said, for not listening to me twice. So why? You told me one thing. He said, no, I told you two things. I told you don't eat it on the street, and you ate it on the street. Second order, I told you eat it in the house. And you didn't eat it in the house. So I'm punishing you twice. Say, what? You joking? It's the same thing. He's right. It's the same thing. But it appears in the Torah in two different versions. You get different punishments. Also, you should know that restriction is much bigger than not doing a mitzvah taseh. You have all your wealth for not violating the restriction. But if it's a positive mitzvah, up to 20% of your net worth. So you see, the obligation not to violate a restriction is more severe than not doing a mitzvah taseh. Mitzvah number, we'll try to get to 450 today. 441, to redeem the kodashim shenafal ba'emum v'achar kach mutarim ba'achila. When you take an animal and say this is a sacrifice for Bet HaMikdash, right away it becomes holy. What happened if a tree fell, there was a hurricane, a tree fell and the eye of this animal came out? Or he cut his ear. Or I don't know, took his leg off. That's called Baal Mum. It has a defect now. Can you sacrifice a defected animal to God? It's an embarrassment. It cannot be. So what do? You redeem it with money and buy a different animal. Why? Because this cannot be sacrificed. So what happened with the one with the defect? They become regular. They lost their holiness. Once you redeem it with money and bought a different animal, the holiness goes to the next animal. If nothing happened to the first animal, you just like it because it's fat, you're going to make steaks for yourself, and you say, you know what, let me keep this and I'll give a different animal, you're not allowed. Naturally, something happened to it, it's a different story. It's an act of nature. So it becomes a secular thing that it's not holy anymore. וזופחים ואוכלים אותם הבעלים כחולים גמור. Then mitzvah number 442, not to eat ma'aser sheni of dagan michutz leYerushalayim. The five kinds of grains, when you cut your wheat, barley, all the things from your fields, 10% you have to give to the Levi in the time of Bet HaMikdash. And from the 10% that the Levi got a huge pile of grain, he gives 10% to the Kohen. So the Kohen really got 1% from the entire thing that the farmer bought. That 10%, right, you have to eat it inside Yerushalayim. Cannot eat it out of Yerushalayim. Which means, what happened if a person he cannot carry 1 ton of wheat, especially when the days that they had donkey and horses. He has a huge 100-acre field. Huge pile from here to the ceiling of wheat. How is he going to carry it to Yerushalayim? You need 500 donkeys with bags. It's a big thing. He's a big farmer. So they sell it, and when the money that they got, they buy food and they eat it in Yerushalayim, right? So if what happened if he wants to make a meal for the poor people here in, in Tel Aviv, where he lives? He doesn't want to go all the way. There is not allowed. They have to eat it inside Yerushalayim. Right? So, what happened if a person ate it out is violating the rules? Does the Beit Din give him patches with the whip? The answer is no. Usually, some of the sins, they warn him, and if he continue to do it, they take him to the court, to the Beit Din, and whip him. But here, it's not the case. It's just that he violated the rules of the Torah. Mitzvah number 443, not to eat the ma'aser sheni of tirosh. What's tirosh? We have dagan, tirosh, and itzar. Tirosh means wine, grapes. The wine that you make from the grapes. Itzar means oil. Oil. There's a company in Israel of oil, olive oil. They call themselves itzar. That's the name. Why? It comes from the Torah. There's yain tirosh, wine tirosh. Why? Tirosh in the Torah means wine. From the grape. And dagan, it's the five kinds of grains. Food, bread, whatever you make from it. So what happened now if you took the grapes and you have to give 10%? Also not allowed to eat it out of Yerushalayim. Same exact concept. Mitzvah number 444, not to eat ma'aser sheni of oil. Same thing, the ma'aser sheni that you want to eat it out of Yerushalayim. Not allowed to eat out of Yerushalayim. Mitzvah number 445, not to eat bechor tamim chutz l'Yerushalayim. The Kohen, all the bechorot, animals that is born, the first sheep that was born from this mother, is holy. It belongs to the Kohen. One of the things when we bring tefillin, one of the things on a sticker that they tell you that this tefillin is special, they write, lo mi bechor. Not from a firstborn animal. Why? It doesn't belong to us. It belongs to the Kohen. You understand? So we make sure that it doesn't go from their skin to make tefillin. Okay? So what happened now? The Kohen received it. He got it. And he wants to eat it in Tel Aviv. And the time Beit HaMikdash was there, not allowed. It's holy. Holy only in Yerushalayim. Nowhere else. You understand? You see the importance of Yerushalayim. Lo tuchal le'echol b'she'arecha בכורות, בקרחה וצונחה, cows and sheep, firstborn, only in Yerushalayim. Right? מצווה number 446, לא לאכול בשר חטאת ואשם חוץ לקלעים ואפילו כהנים. The basar, the meat of the animals that call korban חטאת and אשם. It's two different sacrifices. חטאת is when a person made and not intentional sin. We spoke about it in previous lectures. And asham, when a person is guilty of something, he brings this asham. So it says that the Kohanim that sacrifice it and all that, they can only eat it, they're not allowed to eat it out of the klaim. There's a place, Kalei HaMishkan, there's a place, well, it's hard for me to explain, but if you see a picture of everything in Beit HaMikdash, then there's a place called klaim. They're not allowed to eat it out. There's a special wall. They have to eat it inside and not outside. This is all secret. We will never understand all the secrets of God. This is divine instructions. You understand? You don't understand? Doesn't matter. This is what God said to do. Who am I not to listen? So you want it here? We'll do it here. Your secrets we'll understand one day when Mashiach comes. 447, not to eat besar ha'olah. Korban, that's called korban olah. Olah means go up to Hashem. No permission to eat from it, like other sacrifices, part of it go to eating. This korban is burned completely to Hashem. Nobody eats from it. Lo tuchal le'echol oto. No one is allowed to eat from it. Right? Whether before you throw the blood on the altar, whether after you did it, It doesn't matter location, you're here or not here, anywhere, no one is allowed to eat from it. Mitzvah number 448, not to eat besar kadashim kalim, light holiness, the lower level of holiness of these sacrifices. It's called kodashim kalim. You're not allowed to eat it before you throw the blood to burn on the altar. After you splash the blood on the altars, as the Torah instructed the Kohen to do, after that you can eat from the meat. But before that, you're not allowed to eat from it. What is it called, Kodashim Kalim? When a person wants to say thank you to Hashem, like I said before. It's not an obligation. You donate it. So that's called Kodashim Kalim. It's all appear in Mishnayot, in Masechet Zvachim, chapter 5. You can see the different kinds of sacrifices over there. Mitzvah number 449, that the Kohanim will not eat Bikurim before they put them inside that big room in Beit HaMikdash that called Azara. What's Bikurim? The fruit that become ripe first on the tree. When the farmers come to cut, the first one who became ripe, they take them out, put them in a special basket, and in a holiday of Shlosha Regalim, they take it to the Beit HaMikdash and give it as a gift to the Kohanim. Today we don't have Beit HaMikdash, so they give it to the rabbis. You give it to your rabbi, you visit him in Sukkah, you bring a basket, whatever, or wine, or whatever it is. But we're not farmers anyway. Almost nobody is a farmer today, but let's say you're a farmer in Israel, and you have beautiful fruit, and you come to your rabbi that you learned Torah with, and you give it to him. So this is only, it's not a mitzvah from the Torah. It's only a memory of what used to be. It's not an obligation. But by doing it, you're showing Hashem, oh, we miss those days that we took the best fruit and brought it into the Kohanim. And the last mitzvah for today, mitzvah number 450, not to neglect the Levites, the Leviim. We have to give them gift and make them happy in the three festivals, in the Shlosha Regalim, Sukkot, Shavuot, and Pesach. We have to give them the maaser, the 10% from everything that we cut from our Yevul, on time. Not to keep it by us and they're waiting, they need it. They need to leave. They work in Beit HaMikdash all day, right? Don't neglect the Levi, Hashem say, be careful not to neglect him as long as you live on this earth, right? And also, you have to know, this is the children of Moshe Rabbeinu, the Levim, the Shevet Levi, the tribe of Moses, right? So they were chosen to serve in Beit HaMikdash. They sing in a choir, in the orchestra, with the greatest music you ever heard. And they do, and they help the Kohanim, and they patrol around Beit HaMikdash. They have a list of things that they do. They're busy. They cannot go and walk now in 47th Street, sell gold. They're busy in Beit HaMikdash. They have no choice. You know, so therefore Hashem say, don't be ungrateful. You got to give them their living. And by the way, you should know, I always use this as a proof, that when you help someone to do a mitzvah, his mitzvah is yours. It's his also. But it's yours just as much or more. First of all, it says it clearly in the Gemara. Gadol ha-me'aseh yoter min ha-oseh. Someone who make other Jews make mitzvot, his reward is greater than them. That's already one thing that we should know. But the Torah brings a story that Hashem tell Moshe to teach the Leviim, to teach the Levites what to do inside Beit HaMikdash. To do this, not to do this, how to do. And after he teach them everything, the Torah say, the nation of Israel did everything that God instructed Moshe to do. What's going on here? There wasn't for the nation of Israel. They're not allowed to do it. They're not allowed to serve inside Beit HaMikdash. Only Leviim and Kohanim. And the Kohanim cannot do what the Levi can do. The Leviim cannot do what the Kohanim. So it's specifically only for Levi. So why it says the entire nation did it? If that's the case, it will be a sin. What's the point? Of course then they didn't do it. Hashem said to him, only the Leviim. Because the nation of Israel support the Leviim financially, every mitzvah they do goes to the credit of every Jew who gave them 10% of his money. Now, this is only mitzvot of the Leviim. the mitzvot of the Leviim, as important as they may be, doesn't even come anything near saving souls. If you take a Jew and make him religious, from now on, him, his children, it's forever, it's going to be billions of mitzvot, and it makes Hashem very happy. The whole tribe is getting saved now. Him, his children, grandchildren, becomes a whole nation. Think about it. Cain murder Hevel, and after that, from one person, look what the world became. 7 billion people in 5,700 years. So that it's multiplying a lot. So you, thanks to you, this Jew became religious. You helped, you supported, you sent your money, your 10%. I always wonder, everybody must give 10% anyway. You must give. It's not yours. 10% is not yours. You must put aside from your net income. You're not doing anyone a favor. You must give it. Since you must give it, at least you might as well give it to the right place. So there's, I don't know what's going on. It's probably that most people don't even give the 10%. They don't give. Because I tell you how I know. If I get thousands of emails every year, thousands, there are many thousands of people who are going crazy about the lecture, admiring the lecture. What did you just tell me? All week I'm listening from morning to night. All week nonstop. You know how many thousands like you have? Not hundreds, thousands, many, many thousands of people in emails and texts and messages. Ooh, there's no way to count them. Can fill up a few Madison Square Garden with how many people listening and becoming more religious. Where is their 10%, all these people? Should have had $1 billion a month. Where is it? How come I don't even raise a few thousand dollars to make CDs and make other people religious? Where is all the 10% of all these people? Who do they give it to? Yasser Arafat? If they send me so many compliments, you save our life, you save my marriage, you save my children, we all now religious. And so what are they doing with that 10%? Who do they give it to? To the Hamas? I don't even get 1% of 1% of 1% of 1% from their money. It doesn't come, so I don't really know where they give it. There's two possibilities. One is that they're very foolish and they give it to the wrong places. But in my opinion, they just don't give it. It's still from Hashem. They don't give it. Because if they give it, they're not dumb. They know that to save soul is the biggest mitzvah. For them, forget, they're not doing anyone a favor. For them, it's the best investment. Everyone thinks about his future, no? Everyone thinks, I will invest here, then I will have enough money to marry my children and grandchildren. I will have to retire. This will bring me a lot of money. This is the mind of the people. They always think for the future. Let me work hard now and save and invest correctly that in the future I'm going to enjoy my effort, right? Everyone thinks like this. So if a person does give 10%, do you know any other better investment? Just Erev Yom Kippur, I have a guy in Englewood, Baruch Hashem, he's giving. Almost my entire yeshiva in Yerushalayim he supports. One person. And it's 24 salaries of 24 families. He gives, and he convinced sometimes others to give. He could have done a lot more. He has a lot of wealthy friends. With a little bit more efforts, he can raise many, much, much more money. But better not something than nothing. But I used to tell him the numbers of the viewers every month. And I thought he believed me, even though I don't believe myself when I read the number. I see it again, and I say, it cannot be. Then I check again. Okay, yeah, that's what it is. For the last 30 days, the computer don't lie. They give you the insights. Google Analytics, the Facebook Insight, they tell you how many people view the lectures. So on Erev Yom Kippur, Motzei Yom Kippur ended, it was in Englewood. He was washing the floor with the host after all the great tzaddikim left the place. Eli was there, right? Eli, you know who I'm talking about. Okay, so I was sitting with Asher Melamed and his wife. They came from Israel, so they spent Yom Kippur with us. Because he's translating he's putting the Hebrew subtitle into the debate. He's putting it, it's a very hard job to match it to the timing. It's a lot of work, it's 3 hours. So we're going to the computer, I'm checking, you know, so I showed Melamed how many, he asked me, do you think it's worth it for me to put so many hours of work in translating the debate to Hebrew? So I wanted to encourage him. So I say to him, wait, let me get my laptop from the car. I want to show you in one day how many people would watch it already. I opened the laptop, I show him, I say, look, 2.2 million views in the last 30 days. How many days? It's 50, 60, 70,000 views per day on the Facebook alone. This is only in Hebrew, and you're asking me if it's worth to translate it or not. As soon as we put it in, within a week, you're gonna have 500,000 views. Every second person in Israel will watch it. What do you, your Olam Haba, go from level A right away to Z in 1 minute. So I told the guy, come. Here, I always tell you, now we're already here in your house. I showed him the number, he looks. He didn't say anything, he smiled. Now Shabbat, I was in Englewood again. I was in Motzei Shabbat, there was Sheva Brachot of Rabbi Shmuli Boteach daughter. A famous speaker, Shmuli Boteach his name. So his daughter, they live in the same neighborhood. Boteach lives here, Kadhafi lives next door, not anymore. And my friend lives about a fifth of a mile away, in the same block almost. So he made him Sheva Brachot, you know, they're close. So he got up to speak. So he said, he wanted to introduce me to the new guest. So he said, until he showed me in my own eyes, I thought he's exaggerating and telling me stories. But now I have to confess, I never believe you, he said, until you showed me. If I wouldn't see in my own eyes, I'd never believe such thing. More than 2 million views in a month, come on, what is going on here? So now, since he saw it, he became more inspired to help. But why do we have to convince and show? Why? You don't believe, now everything is a lie in this world. But he saw it in his own eyes. So what? So the only way to make people help is to brag? To send them a copy? Here is a copy. See how many views. To brag? Feel lousy. To brag about yourself? The point, the conclusion over here is, you sponsor the Leviim, every mitzvah they did is yours. You sponsor a person who does good mitzvot, his mitzvot is yours. He influenced other people to do mitzvot, his mitzvot, and their children, forever and ever and ever, it's all yours. Now you think if it's worth it for you to invest correctly or not. And also one last thing, if a person has to beg you to send money, it's almost no mitzvah for you. Remember this. Why? Because you're embarrassed. You're embarrassed. You know him, you're embarrassed. He call you, he run after you. That's almost no mitzvah. Yeah, in the end you gave. But you only did it because he forced you and you felt embarrassed. The idea is always, even with a poor person, to give him the money that he needs for the food before he even dare to call you or to send you a messenger. Once he already asks you for the help, your reward is much, much, much lower. Don't ever forget this. If the rabbi of the shul had to come to you and say, help me out, we cannot pay the electric here, they close the tomorrow, it's already too late. Because now you have no choice, you're embarrassed. The idea is to come on your own. You understand? You need help? Here is my money, I gather it. Do the right thing with that. This is a smart investor when it comes to eternity. I know there's a big yetzer hara. The Satan doesn't let you do the right thing. We know this. Even after you give, it eats your heart for a month. What did I do? Am I doing the right thing? Maybe I give too much. Next time, instead of 180, I give 100. I told you the story. One time, I like to tell this story because it's really funny. Sad and funny at the same time. One time, I went to give a lecture in a very fancy, rich place. And there was a woman over there. She told me, can I meet with you across the street from the bank, in the main street of the things, there's a parking lot. I don't want the people to see that I'm talking to you about my daughter. She has a problem. So can I meet with you in a parking lot for 10 minutes before you enter the lecture? I say, okay, I know where this parking is, no problem. So I go there. She comes with her car, I come with my car. So she comes, she say, I want to donate $52. But it's a very wealthy woman. She said, I want to donate $52. You think it's good? I said, very good. Baruch Hashem. Hashem bless you. What am I going to tell her? As we speak, she cries to me about her son, about her daughter, about her husband, about this, about her sister. Oh, I hear the whole Megillat Esther now. She said, do you mind if I'll give 36? I said, no, no problem, also good. Another 15 minutes she talked. I'm telling you, this is exactly how it was. I'm only giving this time 18, okay? I say, well, I stay another 5 minutes, she'll give me $1.80. You understand? And you know what? I promise you one thing. That after she gave the 18, until today she's thinking about it. It's killing her. If you see through 15 minutes how a person is thinking, 52, 36, 18, then even the 18, it's a pain. It's a pain in his heart. Doesn't matter, a penny. You know these people who cut $4 coupon and drive, pay $14 gas to go all the way to Home Depot, Walmart, whatever, those big stores, to save $4, they're not calculating right. They don't know gas is very expensive. The time to go back and forth to save the $4, but they feel so great. Wow, we have coupons. They look at the bill, $2 off, $1 off, $1.50 off. I made $5 extra today. You fool. You lost 15 to save 5. But this is it. That's a sickness. This is 100% sickness. And only way to get out of this sickness is the Torah. Emunah, faith. Strong Emunah, again, Emunah, Emunah, faith. Jews and non-Jews. Faith. You know, I tell you something. One guy, don't want to say names, but he's going to watch this lecture tomorrow. One guy, he said to me, how much it costs to sponsor one of your lectures? I say to him, there's no price. I'm not charging for my lectures. I come for free. You know, if you want to sponsor, whatever you feel it's right, you can sponsor. I'm not in a position to bargain. Every penny who comes to me is like oxygen, because I'm always in shortage of all the payments for gas and tolls and for the CDs. There's a lot of money that I need. It has to go to this work. So any amount of money you give, since I'm going for free anyway, I feel like I found it in the street. So he wrote me back an email. I didn't know your financial situation is so bad. My wife and I save over the years $2,000 emergency money. How should I send it to you? That's all their saving. I almost fainted. I wrote to him, absolutely not. That's your emergency money, don't touch it. But in the future, 10% you must give, everyone must give. So you give your 10%. He makes very nice, doesn't make a lot of money, not a rich guy, but he was willing. This is saving a lot of Jews from debt. Something like this, the Satan comes and says, look at your nation, stingy, they don't care about anyone, egoistic, nobody cares to save souls. The angel comes and says, wait, they show this thing, this guy saved for who knows how many years it took him to save it. It's not a lot of money in America, $2,000, it's not a lot of money. Some people pay an electric bill every month. We're not talking... If a person was willing, he said, I spoke to my wife and right away she agreed. Emergency money for time of problems. Do you know how many people get saved from one Jew like this? You know how many? You have no idea. That's it. Everyone who sponsored the Leviim, the Torah says, "Vayasu bnei Israel kasher tziva Hashem et Moshe." And the nation of Israel did what God ordered Moshe, but He told him for the Leviim, not for the nation of Israel, since they all pay their needs. It counts that they did what the Leviim did. For us, this is a big musar for life. We'll see you bezrat Hashem next week. Thank you very much. Baruch Adonai l'olam. Amen v'amen.
Next week.